pleuris muscle. Plane dissection is done, then the exposure of the periosteum is done. Not only the exposure of the flexure site was done, as you can appreciate in the picture, and then the fixation with the mini plate was done. Then finally, the closure was done in the layers with the muscle layer with the help of the 3-0 piping, and the skin layer with the help of the subcutibular skin closure was done with the help of the 4-0 piping. This is the follow-up of the patient 1 week as well as the 1 month. As you can appreciate, after the 1 month, the scar which was there in the informant region became inconspicuous. Similarly, this is another case was reported to us. This is the case of the beneficial trauma, where you can also appreciate the fracture of the mandible. The ophthalmic examination reveals the similar findings as that of the previous case. This case was special in itself because submental intubation was the choice in this case. Then the traction sutures were applied to the lower eyelid, exposing the palpable conjunctiva. And the incision was given in the conjunctival. Generally, this transconjunctival incision was also facilitated with the help of our little anatomic incision to increase the site exposure. At the same time, the approach for the transconjunctival which we took was the retroceptal approach, because there are two approaches which we can go through the transconjunctival. One is the preceptal, another one is the retroceptal. The chances of injury to the tarsal plate are more in the preceptal, so we choose the retroceptal approach. And accordingly, the dissection was done to expose the periosteum, and the flexure site was exposed, and then fixation of the mini plates was done, and then the closure was done accordingly. And here the closure is very important. First of all, we do not have to give a watertight closure, otherwise the chances of collection of edema, then retropulmonary edema would be there, then chances of blindness are there. And the most important thing is that whenever we are doing a last suture in the lateral direction, then we have to involve the lower limb of the lateral canthal ligament, otherwise chances of ectropion are there postoperatively. This is the follow-up of the patient 15 days. As you can see, this is the incision was in the transconjunctival plane, so there is no evident of any scar. This is the 15 days follow-up of the patient. So if you come to the discussion, we basically compared these two techniques in four main parameters. That is the average time from the incision to the fracture site exposure. In case of transconjunctival, it was less as compared to that of the informant. This is because of the more muscle plane dissection time which was consumed in case of the infraorbital region. If you see the parameter to compare the improved satisfactory exposure to the fracture site, it is similar in both the cases. And if we talk about the early complication of these approaches, then in both the cases, we found that edema on the first, third, and the 1 week postoperative was there. And if you talk about the late complication, then sclera, so ectropion, vision loss, and diplopia was not seen in any of the two cases. And if you see about the appearance of the scar, then we can see that in infraorbital approach, the scar was slightly visible in the beginning days, and after 3 weeks, that the scar also become inconspicuous. And according to Edward Ellis, in infraorbital approach also, since the subcutaneous the tissue is very less, so there are less chances of formation of any keloid or any scar. So in infraorbital approach also, the scar become inconspicuous. But if you talk about the transconjunctival approach, then there was no scar was present even within the 15 days. So if you come to the summary of this this presentation, and then since we know that the current scenario is such that we have to go most of the fracture by the open reduction method, so decision making should be there while planning the choice of the incision in terms of aesthetic also, because now the era is not just coming because of that mechanical reduction, but at the same time aesthetic is also very important. These are my references. Thank you.
So can you tell me what is the difference of the surgical time while exposure? Did you check that also? The time taken for the exposure of the fracture site? The time taken in which?
Generally, we found in infraorbital approach, there was more time to expose the fracture site. And in transconjunctival, if the fracture is not in a so medial direction, then the time was less in case of transconjunctival to expose the fracture site.
What difficulties did you face with the transconjunctival approach?
Ma'am, first of all, it is means technique sensitive, and we have to decide which transconjunctival approach we are going to take, either preceptal or retroceptal. So, accordingly, since it is a technique sensitive as compared to that of the infraorbital.
So, you were doing both the preceptal and
No, no, ma'am. In this case, we choose a retroseptal approach because chances of tarsal plate injury are more in case of the preseptal.
So you found transconjunctival approach better than intraorbital approach?
Yes, ma'am. If you talk about in terms of aesthetic.
Other terms, what are the drawbacks for transconjunctival?
Ma'am, drawbacks are, like as I told you, while closer, we have to take care that the lower limb of the lateral canthal ligament has to be included in the suture. So if you are not including it, then chances of post-operative ectropion are there. And at the same time, if you are giving a very wide, that watertight sealed sutures, then chances of retrobulbal edema collection are there and chances of blindness are there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What is the profile thickness of the plate that is used?
It was 1.5 mm thick.
Not 2. Because in the second case, I thought that it was a much thicker profile thick plate. It's only 1.5. In the second case that you presented, I felt that it was a 2 mm plate that was used. Was it 1.5 or 2?
1.5, sir.
Okay, okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. I think if there are no more questions, we can go to the next presenter, right?
Yes. Dr. Bhavna, you can go to the next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Shilpaji, can we switch to the next speaker, please?
Yes. Go to the presentation mode. And your time starts now.
Dr. Sumit Anand, please start. Your time has started.
Dr. Sumit Anand.
Yes, ma'am.
Your time has started. Please start.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. Am I visible?
Yes.
Okay. Center giant cell granuloma is a benign, proliferative, intraosseous and non-odontogenic lesion of unknown etiology, accounting for less than 7% of benign tumors of the jaw. According to the World Health Organization, CGCG is defined as an intraosseous lesion consisting of more or less fibrous tissue containing multiple foci of hemorrhage, aggregates of multiple multinucleated giant cells, some amount of trabeculae of woven wound forming within the septa of mature fibrous tissue and may transverse the lesion. So this CGCG shows a predilection for females and is more usually seen in age groups below 30 years. Just a second. Next slide is. Actually, there's a hanging issue with my laptop. Just a second, ma'am.
Dr. Sumit, first click inside the PPT, then press next or use the arrow.
Yes. So frequency of CGCG is twice as often in mandible than in maxilla, as and it appears as a solitary, unilocular, or multilocular radiolucency. The behavior from being a slow growing asymptomatic osteolytic lesion to an aggressive and lesion featuring pain, local bone destruction, and root resorption. Hereby, we present a management of a locally aggressive central giant cell granuloma involving the lower jaw, which was successfully managed with marginal mandibulectomy and reconstructed with submental flap. So a 50-year-old female patient reported to our department in December 2019 with complaint of a swelling present inside her mouth, Patient was apparently well 6 months back when she noticed a spontaneous swelling inside her mouth in the lower left jaw region, which started growing rapidly over the course of next 6 months. The patient gave history of extraction with respect to lower left back tooth 4 months back, after which the swelling increased even more rapidly. She also reported bleeding gums, pain, foul breath, weakness, along with loss of appetite. So the profile pictures show the swelling on the left side of her jaw, which gives an asymmetry to her face. On intraoral examination, a 5 into 3 centimeter lesion extending from the distal of 3-3 up to the retromolar region was observed in her oral cavity, which was soft in consistency, and there was grade 1 mobility with respect to 3-3 and 3-2. Therefore, a diagnostic evaluation was done in which OPGs, computer tomography, and histopathology was done. So all these reports showed the diagnosis as central giant cell granuloma. Here we can see the lesion in the bone on the left side. Then we have bony destruction in the coronal view as well as in the axial view. This is the 3D reconstruction showing the invasion of the bone by the lesion. This is the biopsy report, which projects the giant cells consisting of 6 to 7 nuclei, which are small or oval in shape, having prominent nuclei as well as fibrocellular stroma. Also, there is numerous endothelial cell lining the blood vessels of varying shapes and sizes in the stroma with focal areas of hemorrhage. So talking about the surgical procedure, a surgical procedure with of resection along with reconstruction with submental flap was planned. A combination of extraoral and intraoral approach was used to excise the lesion completely. Here we can see the excision of the lesion was done, lesion was taken out from the oral cavity, and along with that, extended marginal mandibulectomy was done along with the bony debridement. Subsequently, a submental island flap was raised and mobilized to be transported intraorally into the defect. Following that, the reconstruction plate was used to support the mandible because it was weakened due to marginal mandibulectomy, and then a primary closure was done in the donor site. The post-operative healing was uneventful, and the patient recovered completely. This picture shows the intraoral flap, which is in a good condition. So the histological diagnosis in this such cases is confirmed only by presence of fibroblastic stroma and spindle-shaped cells, which are multi-nucleated giant cells. Most widely used intervention is curettage. It ranges from simple curettage to resection in addition to cryosurgery and peripheral osteotomy. N-block surgical resections with a 5 mm margin has shown to be one of the lowest recurrence, and non-surgical treatments with alpha interferon, calcitonin, denosumab, corticosteroids have also been described in literature as adjuvants or also as definitive treatments. Intralesional steroid injection as an alternative was first used in 1988 by Jacobi et al. So the rationale behind using it was, hypothesized that the steroid injection would cause inhibition of extracellular lysosomal enzymes or proteases produced by the giant cell. Also, it causes apoptosis in osteoclast-like cells, thereby preventing the resorption. Calcitonin therapy is also used via subcutaneous injections or intranasal sprays. And this is a conservative therapy, and it also helps to prevent the resorptions by inhibiting the multinucleated giant cells and stimulating the osteoblasts. Anti-bone resorptive human monoclonal antibodies like denosumab have giant prominence in therapy of CGCG because it binds to receptor activator of nuclear factor kappa, thereby inhibiting the maturation process of the osteoclasts. Recommended treatment length for this treatment is 12 months, and monitoring is done by PET, CT, or MRI. Coming on to conclusion, these kind of aggressive CGCG tumors, once treated, need regular follow-up as there is a chance of recurrence. After surgery, antibiotics, analgesics, and steroids are required along with monitoring of clinical and radiological parameters. The submental pedicle flap provides an adequate volume for reconstruction of larger defects and is a reliable method if all the correct surgical protocols are followed. These are my references. Thank you.
Hello. I request chairpersons to ask any question, ask the questions if there are any, please.
Yeah, what is the recurrence rate in?
Sir, recurrence.
And what is the follow up?
Sir, recurrence rate is around 11 to around 50%, and sir, follow up is done till 12 months.
No, no. What is the follow up of this case?
This patient, sir. So this patient, we had performed the surgery in January, and we have followed her up till May, sir.
2019.
Sir, in January 2020, we operated the patient and followed up her up till 2020 May.
Okay, so 5 months follow up.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And so there was no recurrence, and the plaque was surviving well in the defect.
What is the percentage of follow up in recurrence in 5 months? What is the protocol for follow-up in these cases?
In central giant cell granuloma, what is the rate of recurrence and when does the recurrence occur? This is what sir wants to.
Okay, ma'am. So, ma'am, the rate of recurrence would be...
When do you expect the lesion to reoccur?
Okay. Ma'am, the recurrence would be around, I guess, 3 months.
Okay. Would you consider any time of using bone graft in such cases when you are using a flap also? Will you given a choice, will you do a bone grafting also?
Ma'am, if there is extensive amount of osteotomy done and there is high chances of fracture, then we might consider a graft also.
Like in this case, there was an extensive loss of bone, yes, because ma'am. Of the lesion involvement of the with the lesion.
Yes, ma'am. Here, ma'am, we supported it with a reconstruction plate. So, here we felt the strength is enough to avoid a graft.
Even if you place a graft, you need a reconstruction plate, right?
Yes, ma'am.
But what's the chances of the exposure of these reconstruction plates?
Sir, it will depend upon the like patient's hygiene and the post-op care that we are providing.
Okay, I think if there are no more questions, we'll go to the next.
Right, sir. Right, sir. Let's go to the.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Dr. Sumit.
Thank you.
Hello. Excuse me. Yeah, I would like to invite the next speaker, Dr. Gaurav.
Yes, ma'am.
Gaurav, please turn on your video.
Ma'am, video is
turned on. It is 8 minutes plus 2 minutes discussion, is it, Shilpa?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Gaurav?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Please share your screen.
Please introduce yourself when you are starting with your topic.
Go to the presentation mode.
Is it visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Yes, and your time starts now.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Gaurav Bhagya from Institute of Dental Science, Bareilly, postgraduate student JR1. The topic of my paper presentation is a treatment algorithm for odontogenic keratocyst. The odontogenic keratocyst, which was earlier referred as keratocystic odontogenic tumor, is a distinctive form of developmental odontogenic cyst. It is defined as a benign aggressive lesion of the jaws, maxilla, and the mandible with a serious potential for morbidity. It deserves a special consideration because of its peculiar clinical behavior. In comparison to the other cysts of the jaws, OKC is unique because of its distinguishing clinical features, potentially aggressive behavior, and a high recurrence rate, and its association with the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome, The OKC of the jaw have been considered as the most debated pathological cystic lesion in the maxillofacial region. A great attention is to be given to OKC since with time it has been evident that it may grow and expand to a large size before becoming clinically evident, unlike the other jaw sets, which have a great, and it also has a greater tendency to recur after a surgical treatment. And in this modern era of so much advanced form of diagnostics, the OKC remains a mystery as it can also cause a bony erosion or vital invasion, skull base extension, and a temporal fossa violation. Coming to the epidemiology, OKC may be found in population which range from infancy to the old age, with a slight male predilection. Mandible is involved in the 60 to 80% of the cases with noticeable tendency to the posterior body and the ascending ramus of the mandible. Coming to the etiology is possibly closely related to the development from the dental lamina and its remnants when the enamel organ has served its purpose. It occurs in the dentate areas of the maxilla and the mandible, which is, as I told, derived from the remnants of the dental lamina. It usually lies in the remnants lies in the gingiva and the pedial fiber, but it is still unknown why it rises from these epithelial residues or epithelial islands. Coming to the symptoms, the patient may complain of pain, swelling, and discharge, but sometimes the lesion may attain a large size or develop pathological fractures when a patient notices it. But OKC may be identified unexpectedly, which I will be telling you in my two cases which I will present, during radiographic examination. In many cases, the patients are astonishingly free of symptoms, unlike until the cyst reach a large size. Coming to the treatment, the many attempts have been made to reduce the high recurrence rate of OKCs by modification in the operative technique. Still, there is no foundation on a uniform treatment plan, and the recommended treatment varies from the mass supplication to an end block resection, depending on the various factors such as the age, location of the lesion, size, and whether it's a primary or a recurrent lesion. The following treatment plans can be followed: enucleation, mass supplication followed by enucleation followed by a resection, curettage or a peripheral osteotomy, or Corney solution or a modified Corney solution, or a enucleation followed by a cryotherapy, and ultimately resection can also be done. Main surgical treatment is either mass supplication, then enucleation followed by liquid nitrogen, that is the cryotherapy, or Corney solution, or a peripheral osteotomy, and ultimately a resection can also be done. From our series of cases from our center, two cases I will describe. In these two cases, the OKC was an incidental finding. The patient was undergoing treatment in an other outside center for an unhealed socket in 4-7 and 4-8, for which he had undergone extraction 2 months back. And from 2 months, he was undergoing treatment for the same, and the patient was referred to our center, and as a routine radiographic diagnosis, we did an OPG, and a radiolucent lesion was present in the ramus region, and the patient has had no signs or symptoms or any sort, and patient was totally unaware of such thing. You can observe the unhealed socket with the 4-7 region. A treatment plan was done, that is the enucleation was done followed by the chemical cauterization with modified Corney solution under GA. This is the post follow-up, post-op, sorry. This is the follow-up. Coming to the second case, this also was an incidental finding. Patient was going for an extraction with the 4-7, and the outside center, and the patient underwent a routine OPG. And then she was referred to our center as there was a radiolucent lesion present in the body continuing to the ramus region, which was both the cases were ultimately histopathologically diagnosed as OKC. And in this also, the enucleation was done followed by a modified Corney solution with a application of the reconstruction plate. Coming to the discussion, OKC has a particular tendency to recur after a surgical treatment. The first to point out this aggressive behavior was the Pinberg and Hasten in 1963. Recurrence more often occurs in the mandibular OKC, particularly those in the posterior body and the ascending ramus. Multiple recurrences are not unusual. Although OKC may recur within 5 years of the original surgery, a significant number of recurrences may not be manifested until 10 or more years. So a long follow-up is needed for a surgically treated OKC after the original surgical procedure. OKC may arise from the proliferation of the basal cells of the oral mucosa, predominantly in the third molar region and the ascending ramus of the mandible. Coming to my conclusion, in our opinion, enucleation with chemical cauterization with modified Carney's solution is an excellent treatment option for OKC. Major surgical interventions such as a resection or reconstruction should be limited to cases with recurrence or in cases where there's an aggressive pattern seen. Therefore, the patients should have a radiograph and a clinical examination at regular intervals, and a long follow-up should be there. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gaurav. Over to the chairpersons.
Dr. Gaurav, yes, speaking ma'am. Of the algorithm, yes, so what is your way of diagnosing that, making a surgical plan for the, like, which approach are you are going to take for which patient? You have not shown the algorithm which you are talking about.
Ma'am,
like, in which cases you will go, you will do which type of option will you going to take, select? Ma'am. The
depending
option.
On the if there's a aggressive pattern, then as I told
you, what do you mean by aggressive pattern? Ma'am, how will you define the aggressive pattern?
Ma'am, aggressive pattern is the involvement of the large portion of the involved place and involved region, and if there's multiple OKCs, that is considered also as an aggressive pattern in that cases. And
so in those cases you'll do for
Yes, ma'am. If the excessive involvement of the bone has occurred and there's no any other option, that any remodeling of the bone will be done. So resection is the resection followed by reconstruction should be done.
So you have basically not defined the area which the like area the. OKC is involving, like it's 2 centimeter, 3 centimeter, maybe more than 4 centimeter, then you'll go for this. And you're talking about multiple lesions, OKCs, then you're not going to treat it as an aggressive lesion. Will you go for resection multiple sites? That means.
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
So when are you going to use the cornoids? When are you going to use the peripheral ostectomy? Or you are going to use both at one time? Or when, like, have you defined in these,
ma'am,
have you made any criteria, like, in
yes,
the...
ma'am, we didn't use peripheral ostectomy because there's an option of, because there's a chances of extension of the daughter's, the invaded cells inside the bone. And it can causes in other regions also OKCs. Because of that, we have not used a peripheral ostectomy. We did a chemical cauterization for that.
So you think the satellite cyst or the they can cause a recurrence because if you do the peripheral ostectomy? Is there anything defined in the literature, or this is your own notion?
No, ma'am. Ma'am, there's a article which a PubMed article. I don't exactly the author name.
They say that if you do the peripheral ostectomy, then there are chances of recurrence.
Yes, ma'am. There were some articles quoting that. If
so, please share it with me next time. Okay.
Sorry, ma'am.
It's over to you, Dr. Jensen. Yes.
Thank you for the presentation. Anyway, okay. Yeah. I mean, if there are multiple OKCs, and how would you resect?
That's what I was thinking. Yeah. That aggressiveness is not the multiple OKCs. Okay, yeah. Aggressiveness is when the lesion grows to a large size in a small duration of time.
Ram is there in the group, and everybody is there in the group. You can share that article in the group itself if you have one.
No problem at all.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yeah. Gaurav. Yeah, good presentation. Let's go to the next speaker.
Dr. Sanjeev?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can share your screen.
Yes, ma'am.
Go to the presentation mode. And your time starts now.
Good evening, everybody. Myself, Dr. Sanjeev Sharma. I'm a JR3 from Maharashtra Institute of Dental Science. My today's paper presentation topic is microderma abrasion for rejuvenation of facial skin. The content of my paper presentations are introduction, aim, materials, methods, results, discussion, and conclusion. Now, let's talk about the introduction of microderma abrasion. Uneven skin tone and texture along with tan pigmented skin. Tan pigmented skin nowadays are the common encounter conditions faced by individual, which is the most common reason for the lowering the confidence of individual, affecting their personality, resurfacing and protecting the rejuvenated new skin surface gained with diamond. Microderma abrasion is a good option for it. Microderma abrasion is a minimally invasive procedure used to renew all over skin tone and textures. It can improve the appearance of sun damage, wrinkles, fine lines, age spot, acne scarring, melasma, and other skin related concerns and conditions. The procedure uses a special applicator with an abrasive surface to gently send away the thicker outer layer of the skin to rejuvenate it. There are two basic types of microderma abrasions, that is a crystal microderma abrasion and the diamond microderma abrasion. They both offer similar benefit, but the process between two is slightly different. Microderma abrasion is a popular cosmetic procedure because it works on the both the outer layer of the skin called the epidermis as well as the deep layer of the skin, the dermis. The aim of this study to remove the tanned and hyperpigmented skin along with promotion of better tone and texture of the skin by mechanical exfoliation of stratum corneum through diamond burrs for resurfacing of the skin at the interval of 15 days for periods of 3 months. Based on the inclusion and exclusion criteria, 5 study subjects were included in the studies. The patient have signed the informed consent before the start of studies. Patient have treated with diamond microderma abrasion at every 15 days for approximately 6 visits. A clinical examination was carried out at every recalled visit and finding compared with those at the beginning of the treatment. The results were analyzed with chi-square test. Methodology, these are the inclusion criteria. The inclusion criteria, patient of age group of 20 to 40 years are included. Patients who are signed the consent for the study were included. Patients who were not having any signs of allergy of skins are included. Exclusion criteria, patients above 40 years age are not included in the studies. Patient who have any signs of allergy were not included. Now let's talk about the procedure. A diamond tip handpiece is gently exfoliated the dead cell of the facial skin. At the same time, it will suction them off immediately with a vacuum suction. The depth of the abrasion may be affected by the pressure applied on the handpiece as long how the suction is allowed to remain the skin. And one more point I want to add, before, if you want a good facial skin and you don't want to the scar to be increases, we have to think 10 times before we are, you know, going down to the stratum corneum layer. This type of its microderma abrasion applicator generally used in more sensitive facial areas like close to the eyes and in the affected parts. Stroke with pressure is given in all the direction to worn out the stratum corneum of the facial skin. Same procedure is repeated after 15 days for minimum 6 visits to get the best results. This is one of the my patient's pic where I have treated for the acne pores, and these are the results after 3 months. Now, microderma abrasion is extremely popular and is estimated to be the second most performed cosmetic procedures by the American Academy of Cosmetic Surgery. Compared with derma abrasions and chemical peels, this procedure intends to create a gentle superficial mechanical abrasion of the skin to the depth of the epidermis only. It is generally considered as a safe procedure with minimal adverse effect if all the precautions and under aseptic condition has been done. Complications can happen with microderma abrasion, however. Abrasion from improperly performed procedures can result in pinpoint bleeding, petechiae, purpura, streaks of PIH once they heal. If the depth of the wound reaches the papillary dermis or the negative pressure of the handpiece is too instant. So now my conclusion is diamond microderma is better than non-invasive method for resurfacing of skin with improving the tone and texture along with the removal of tan hyperpigmented skin surface. Thank you.
a very short, quick presentation. I have a question. Is this permanent or do you have to do it quite often, or if so, what is the...
Sir, this maintenance therapy first starts at every month, once in a 1 month for 6 months, and then every 6 months, and then once in a year. And so basically it depends on patients, what the new skin has been come, how is this protecting, like basically from the sunlight. So basically the using sunscreen lotion, SPF, is mandatory.
What is the SPF percentage that you'd have to use? Is there any particular thing that you recommend? Or?
Sir, it depends on the thickness of the skin, and basically it's not about the concentration, only very thin layer we should, you know, apply it. Like just like a, you know, varnish type thing. Like it should not be more also, it should not be less also. And the best way, if it is a dry skin, so I always tell the patient to apply glycerin overnight twice in a week. And if it is more oily skin, then apply glycerin once in a week, because it's a glycerin is a good rehydrating agent.
Okay. Will it lead to any itching or something after the procedure?
Sir, only it depends on the technique. If you reach more than the stratum corneum, this itching and everything can occur. But if you are up to the stratum corneum layer, nothing happens. Only the slight, very slight burning sensation occur for 1-2 hours after the procedure.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Zaina.
Yeah. So have you done the cases with wrinkles also? Patients with wrinkles for this?
Yes, ma'am. I have done the cases for this.
Since you have included 20 to 40 years of age to have...
Actually, ma'am, ma'am, I have started with my... this. Actually, I have practices 7 years also during a BDS. So I started this procedure to my assistant only. She is 40 years. So she was having the circumorbital pigmentation and slight wrinkle. So it has been given not exact 100% results for wrinkles, but quite 50 to 60% improvement is there in 2 months.
So basically it's a technique sensitive. You have to be careful while using the machine.
Yes, sir.
And it requires like monthly, maybe 6 monthly or yearly visits to the doctor.
Yes,
right?
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
And SPF is not your consideration for sunblock, huh? SPF percentage is not important.
No, ma'am. Only the take precaution and make the skin rehydration and nutrition properly. Even I have make my this own nutritions also with the soybean Dove, soybean oil, glycerin, vitamin E and vitamin B complex. So it's a nourishing the skin of the face, and it's giving me a very good results. Even I keep on doing on my face also everyone.
So if you can give the tips to the participants today.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay, welcome.
No more questions. I think we can proceed to the next participant.
Hmm. Okay, ma'am. I would like to welcome Dr. Samujwal Das.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, is it visible?
You may start.
Yes, your time starts now.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I am Dr. Samujwal Das from Guru Nanak Institute of Dental Science and Research. Today, I'm going to present a paper on an institutional experience of rare malignant neoplasms in maxillofacial region. Basically, this paper deals with a topic which is though rare, but important for maxillofacial surgeons. So basically, according to NCCN, head and neck cancer is the sixth most common cancer worldwide. And oral cancers rank among the top three cancer, and it accounts for about 30% of all all cancers. About 90 to 95% of oral cancers are oral squamous cell carcinomas. Rest are rare malignant neoplasms. In our day-to-day practice, we encounter these rare malignant neoplasms, which have different biological behavior in terms of their spread and lymph node involvements, and also they have different treatment modalities. Now I'm going to share some cases of rare malignant neoplasms we have managed in our center. So basically, this patient came to our OPD with exophytic growth with ulceration in anterior maxillary teeth region. Radiograph showed bone distraction in anterior heart palate and floor and lateral wall of the nasal cavity. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be rhabdomyosarcoma. The incidence of rhabdomyosarcoma in head region is about 35 to 40%, and in oral cavity about 10 to 12%. Only 24 cases have been reported till now. These are the staging of the rhabdomyosarcoma according to various groups, and these are the management options according to various groups. For group 1 to group 3, surgery along with adjuvant radio and chemotherapy is the treatment option. But in case of group 4, actinomycin D is added to the ABA protocol. In this case, we did wide local excision of the lesion, then followed up with packing of the defect with a whited varnish and impression compound. This is the post-operative picture of the patient. These are the 5-year DFS according to various groups. Another case with mobile segment in the right maxillary teeth region. The zygomatic arch was absent, which was evident on the 3D reconstruction. CMRI showed a tumor mass in the right infratemporal region with intracranial extension. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be diffuse astrocytoma. The incidence of diffuse astrocytoma in head region is about 3.05%. Only 6 cases have been reported till now. These are the management options according to various groups. This patient belonged to group grade 2, and in this case we removed the lesion from the ITF and also excised the level 5 lymph node and sent for HP evaluation. This is the post-operative picture of the patient, and this is the 5-year DFS. Then another case with reduced mouth opening, about 2 finger. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be synovial sarcoma. The incidence of synovial sarcoma in head neck region is about 10%. The only 3 cases of synovial sarcoma located in ITF have been reported till now. Radiograph showed a narrowing of the left condyle and also SOL involving the ITF. These are the management options according to risk groups. This patient belonged to high risk group, and in this case access osteotomy was done. Then removal of the lesion from the ITF was done along with excision of the left condyle. This is the post-operative picture of the patient, and the 5-year DFS is 50 to 60%. Then another case with black pigmentation in the anterior mandibular region. On scraping the lesion, melanin pigmentation was present. Radiographs didn't show any bony erosion, but there was presence of bilateral submandibular lymphadenopathy. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be mucosal melanoma. The incidence of mucosal melanoma in head neck region is about 0.7 to 3.8%. These are the most commonly involved sites in decreasing order. These are the treatment options for mucosal melanoma. In this case, marginal mandibulectomy followed up with bilateral MRND was done. A pigmented node was present in left level 2 region. Then this is the postoperative picture of the patient. This is the 5-year DFS for mucosal melanoma. Another case with exophytic growth with ulceration in right posterior mandibular teeth region. This patient had the history of renal cell carcinoma 5 years ago. Radiograph showed bone destruction distal to four region. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be renal clear cell carcinoma. The metastasis of renal cell carcinoma in head neck region is about less than 1%. 8 to 15% of all cases of metastasis in head neck region are associated with renal clear cell carcinoma. Then this is the treatment option. Basically, surgery is the only treatment option as it is resistant to radiotherapy and chemotherapy. In this case, wide local excision of the lesion was done. This is the post-operative picture of the patient, and the 5-year DFS is 2.24%. Then another case with exophytic growth with ulceration on the right side of the face. Radiograph showed SOL causing destruction of the posterolateral wall of the maxillary sinus as well as the medial wall, and without destruction of the palate and involving the ITF. Then biopsy was done, which revealed humeral right rosettes, which are suggestive of primitive neuroectodermal tumors. The incidence of PNET in head neck region is about 2 to 7%. Only 26 cases have been reported till now. Surgery with or without CT or RT is the treatment option. In this case, access osteotomy was done, ITF clearance, maxillectomy 3A, along with ipsilateral extended SOHNT was done with reconstruction with lateral forehead flap. This is the 5-year DFS. Another case with swelling in the left submandibular region. Radiographs didn't show any significant finding. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be plasmacytoma. The incidence of plasmacytoma in head and neck region is about less than 1%. These are the most commonly involved in decreasing order. These are the treatment options. In this case, excision of the lesion was done and sent for HP evaluation. This is the post-operative picture of the patient. Then the patient was sent for radiotherapy. The 5-year DFS is less than 50%. Another case with extraoral swelling on the left side of the face with normally appearing underlying mucosa. A radiograph showed bone destruction over the ramus of the mandible, and also SOL involving the ITF. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be leiomyosarcoma. The incidence of leiomyosarcoma in headache region is 4%. This is a treatment option, surgery with adjuvant CCRT. Neck dissection is not required. So in this case, we did bilocal excision of the lesion, segmental mandibulectomy with disarticulation of condyle and ITF clearance, followed up with the reconstruction with submental flap. This is the post-operative picture of the patient. This is the five-year DFS, around 24%. Another case with exophytic growth in the anterior mandibular region. Radiograph showed bone restriction over the lower border of the mandible in the right body region, irregular pattern of trabecular pattern of bone over, all over the mandible, and obliteration of maxillary sinus with cancellous bone. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be osteosarcoma. The incidence of osteosarcoma in headache neck region is less than 1%. This is the treatment option. In this case, segmental mandibulectomy followed by reconstruction with submental flap was done. The 5-year survival surgery alone is 15%. And surgery with chemotherapy 60 to 80%. Another case with extraoral swelling over the right side of the face with normally appearing underlying mucosa. Radiograph showed bone extraction over the ramus region, and then FDG PET was done, which revealed moderate metabolic activity over the ITF region with SUV max greater than 3.5. Then biopsy was done, which came out to be primary intraosseous odontogenic squamous cell carcinoma. The 200 cases have been reported till 2018. This is the management options. In this case, we did wide local excision of the lesion, segmental mandibulectomy with disarticulation of condyle, maxillectomy 2A, and ITF clearance. Then this is the post-operative picture of the patient. Then the patient was sent for radiotherapy. Another case with exophytic growth with ulceration on the in the right, left side of the mandible, spider telegactasia was present over the skin. Then radiograph showed SOL with radiopaque foci with CT having the CT number of 110 to 330. Then biopsy was done, which showed hypo and hypercellular areas and pale basophilic chondroid tissues and pleomorphic chondrocytes. Then IC was done, which was positive for S100 and KY67. So this was a case of chondrosarcoma. The incidence of chondrosarcoma in headache disease is 5.76%. These are the most commonly involved sites. And these are the treatment options according to the various grades. This patient belonged to grade 3. And in this case, wide local excision of the lesion was done. This is the second month post-op, and this is the 8-month post-op. Unfortunately, after that, the patient has recurred. And this patient came to our OPD with the same exophytic growth with ulceration in the right side of the mandible. And the radiograph showed the SOL with radiopaque foci. Increased recurrence rate is associated with grade 3 tumor, and tumor size greater than 8 centimeter. Wide local excision of the lesion was done. This is the post-op picture of the patient. Then another case with extraoral swelling on the right side of the face. Radiograph showed vertical speculation of the mandible and also sunray appearance, and FDG PET was done, which revealed a moderate metabolic activity with SUV max greater than 4. And then biopsy was done, which came out to be Ewing sarcoma. The incidence is 1 to 4%. These are the treatment options, surgery with or without RT, and followed up with chemotherapy. So in this case, wide local excision of the lesion was done. This is the post-operative picture of the patient. The DFS is 30%. These are the summary of all the cases we have done in our center. And all the malignant neoplasms are not oral squamous cell carcinoma. Proper clinical, radiological, histopathological, and ISC evaluation are the key to diagnose these rare malignant neoplasms. So in conclusion,
though you are speaking very fast, but your time is over.
Okay, sir.
So just conclude.
Okay, sir. So there are no definite AGCC or NCCN guidelines for addressing the rare malignant neoplasms. So a little effort should be made from all the centers to share their experiences regarding management of these neoplasms or maxillofacial lesions. That a standard protocol for managing these neoplasms can be made. These are my bibliography and acknowledgement. Thank you all.
Sir, the topics were really interesting.
The topic was big and you have covered well, but slightly exceeded the time. Thank you much, Sumichwal. Nice work done.
Thank you.
I think we'll go to the next presenter.
Right, sir.
Can we move on to the next topic, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Speaker, Dr. Ashwin. Topic, adenogenic ghost cell tumor. Dr. Ashita.
Go to the presentation mode. And your time starts now.
Good afternoon. Kaluri, from postgraduate from Siddhartha Institute of Dental Sciences. Today my topic on paper presentation is dentogenic ghost cell tumor. It is a locally invasive neoplasm which is characterized by ameloblastoma like islands of epithelial cells with a mature connective tissue stroma. Aberrant keratinization may be seen with some dentinoid substance and the ghost cell. It have a male predilection and it occurs in elderly patients, and tendency of occurrence towards in the anterior segments of the mandible is a 68-year male patient by name Kutraju has reported to the Department of OMFS with a chief complaint of swelling in the lower anterior region of the jaw since 6 months. Coming to the history of the present illness, the patient has undergone surgery for this lesion 3 years back. After that, it has been recurred 6 months back. Initially, it is small in size, but it was gradually increased in size, tender, and no paresthesia is present. There is no history of trauma or discharge. Only difficulty in chewing is present. So the past medical history and family history are irrelevant. And in the past dental history, he underwent cystic enucleation for the lesion in the mandibular anterior region between 3-4 and 4-4. And no deleterious oral habits are present. Coming to the general physical examination, there is no abnormality detected, and the patient is moderately built. Posterior is erect, posterior is erect, and patient is gait is coordinated, and vital signs are normal. Coming to the examination of the systems, the patient is with the optic nerve damage in relation to the right eye. Also, coming to the extraoral examination, of facial asymmetry seen in the lower third of the face. There is a diffuse swelling on the mandibular anterior region, approximately 5 into 5 centimeters in size, extending posteriorly till the commissure of the lower lip bilaterally. Superiorly, it extends from the cupid's bow of the lower lip, inferiorly up to lower border of the mandible. The color of the swelling is the same as that of the surrounding skin, and the restricted mouth opening of 25 mm is present. So on palpation, the swelling is soft to firm in consistency, tender, compressible, fluctuant, and ephebrile to touch. Right submandibular and submandibular lymph nodes are palpable, and these are 4 in number, and clicking sounds are present on the right side of the TNG. Coming to the intraoral examination, there is an obliteration of vestibule in the anterior region from 3-4 to 4-4 region, and overlining the surface was of the same color of the surrounding mucosa, and the patient has a class 1 occlusion. And coming to the palpation, it is soft to firm in consistency, tender, and no discharge was present. So these were the intraoral pics of the patient. Coming to the radiolucency, it is a radiolucent lesion extending from 4-4 region to 3-4 region, and here the resorption of the roots can be seen, and these were the occlusal view and the IOPA view of the lesion. And coming to the provisional diagnosis, it is ameloblastoma. Differential diagnosis, infected periapical cyst, adenomatoid odontogenic tumor, central giant cell granuloma, primary intraosseous carcinoma. Coming to the investigations which were done to the patient were 3D CT mandible, blood investigations, biopsy, ECG, and the chest x-ray. This is a 3D CT picture of the patient. It shows a destructive lesion which shows both the buccal and the lingual cortical plates expansion and perforation, and resorption of the roots are seen. All the blood investigations of the patient were normal. Biopsy was performed to this lesion. Coming to the biopsy report, there is a cuboidal to polyhedral odontogenic epithelial cells arranged in the form of sheets, islands, and here the cystic spaces of varying size are bordered by odontogenic epithelial cells. presence of ghost cells with the faint eosinophilic cytoplasm and the shadow of nuclear outline in the odontogenic islands were present. Pale eosinophilic homogeneous dendrinoid masses, which are distributed throughout the session, are present. Collagen fibers, delicate fibroblasts, numerous endothelial lined blood vessels, areas of hemorrhage, muscle, blood, and chronic inflammatory infiltrate are given. Here, the stain, it is stained by Van Jeonsen stain. In this, the yellow color are the ghost cells, and the red, pinkish red stain is the dendrinoid material. And coming to the final diagnosis, it is dendrinogenic ghost cell odontogenic tumor. And mandibular segmental resection from 3-6 to 4-6 were planned, and primary reconstruction with the straight locking reconstruction plate was done. This is a 1 week post-operative pictures of the patient. This is the post-op OPG of the patient. This is the 1 month review of the patient.
So how Thank aggressive you. Is this? Sir, continue.
Yeah, please.
Thank you, Ashitara. I would like to know what is the recurrence rate for dendrinogenic host cell tumors?
Ma'am, it is 30%, ma'am. Many of them are treated with enucleation, but recurrence rate is about
30%. So recurrence rate will be different with the different treatment options?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello. Okay. Over to you, sir.
Yeah. It is a... It is a form of COC, right?
It's a solid variant of COC.
Yeah, well then why is it called as a tumor?
Because it's having some invasive properties here. Usually mitotic activity is not seen.
Characterized by? Is there any specific characteristics?
Sir, it's to having... Say that it's having dendrinoid material and numerous ghost cells, which are the degenerated form of epithelial cells.
Hmm.
And there is a proliferation of epithelial cells also, sir, in form of islands.
Why in this case you've not planned for any reconstruction? Why did you limit only with the reconstruction plate? Is there any specific reason?
First of all, the patient is not affordable, so that's why we didn't go for that option.
Okay, if at all you want to reconstruct, what are the modes of reconstruction in this case?
This can be done with a microvascularized fibula graft.
Okay, it's crossing the midline.
Yes, sir.
So will you consider a double barrel or a single barrel? Is there any indication?
Huh?
Hello, Ashita.
Sir, ma'am.
Answer, sir.
Sir.
Is there any whether you'll go indication for double barrel or single barrel? Fibula.
Ma'am.
Have you understood the question?
Ma'am, I don't have an idea about that.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. It's a nice presentation.
Thanks a lot, everybody. Now I would like to invite Dr. K.C. Ashwani, who will be presenting on setting a gold standard in the prospective ophthalmologist review of treated ZMC fracture.
Go to the presentation mode.
Yes.
And your time starts now.
Good afternoon, everyone. Today, I'm going to present a paper presentation topic on setting a gold standard in post-operative ophthalmologist review of treated ZMC fracture and retrospective study. Introduction: injuries to the middle third of the face destroy the integrity of the orbital skeleton and are frequently complicated by injury to the eye. The management of orbital injuries represent a challenging area of facial trauma treatment. The complex osseous and soft tissue anatomy of orbit and the potential for ocular injuries requires a collaborative approach. Orbital trauma can be isolated to the walls of orbit, but will frequently be associated with other facial injuries. ZMC fracture are associated with various ocular injuries such as subconjunctival hemorrhage, hyphema, diplopia, corneal injuries, mitriasis, and optic nerve injury, amongst others. Some of the other injuries, some of the ocular injuries can persist postoperatively. Hence, there is a need to evaluate and systematically follow up the patient with ophthalmologist review postoperatively. The incidence of traumatic optic neuropathy and other ocular injuries needs a prompt ophthalmologic examination of all patients with ZMC fracture postoperatively, and a protocol is presented. Patients and methods. A study of 45 patients who were diagnosed with ZMC fracture after thorough clinical and radiological examination was undertaken in the Department of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery from 2016 to 2019. A thorough case history was taken in a trauma case history performer. In all the cases, the surgical intervention was taken within 6 days of trauma. Pre- and post-operative ophthalmologic examination was done using prism cover test, SynOpto-4, field of binocular angle, and Hess chart to assess motility disorder. An ophthalmos was detected using Keeler frame. Post-operative PNS view was taken in all subjects to assess the reduction and fixation. This is the case history performer of our department for orbital fracture. This is the case who reported to our department with bilateral ZMC and mandibular parasymphysis with a clinical feature of periorbital ecchymosis and subconjunctival hemorrhage bilateral. This was the case of panfacial fracture with a loss of vision in right eye due to right globe rupture. This is the case with right isolated orbital floor fracture with diplopia, and reconstruction of orbital floor was done using proline mesh. So results, a total of 45 subjects were found with the diagnosis of orbital fracture, of which 40 had undergone operative reconstruction. Of the 45 subjects, 38 had records of pre-operative and post-operative examination by both services available, with 3 undergoing bilateral orbital repair. 25 patients are male with an average age of 30 years. 13 subjects had injury after an assault, 6 after motor vehicle crashes, 7 from falls, and 2 from other blunt trauma. 2 subjects were reconstructed with titanium mesh and 5 subjects with proline mesh. The average interval to repair after injury was 5 days, ranging from 0 to 14 days. And the average follow-up was in the intervals of 3 days, 7 days, 10 days, 1 month, 3 months, and 6 months. Pre-operative ocular injuries were found in almost 91.5% of cases. In 2 cases, blindness was present preoperatively. Minor ocular injuries such as subconjunctival hemorrhage, periorbital edema, ecchymosis, and corneal injury accounted for for most of the cases. So incidence of ophthalmic injuries in our study, periorbital edema and ecchymosis was found in 40 cases, subconjunctival hemorrhage was found in 32 cases, 15 cases diplopia was found, and in 2 cases blindness was there preoperatively. So approaches to infraorbital rim was done with infraorbital approach in 35% and subciliary approach in 65% of the subjects. Types of fractures were orbital fracture alone, orbital floor alone was done in 4 cases. Frontozygomatic suture alone was done in 6 cases. ZMC bone, zygomatic bone was in 4 cases. Infraorbital bone alone was in 5 cases, and ZMC complex was in 25 patients. Discussion: the purpose of this study was to investigate the role of formal postoperative ophthalmology and examination after ORIF of orbital floor fracture. The points of discussion was timing for surgical intervention, the choice of approaches, that is subciliary or infraorbital, orbital rim versus floor, manipulation of displaced fracture segment, comminuted versus linear fractures. Common etiology for orbital floor fractures included assault, road traffic accidents, sports injury, and falls causing mid-facial trauma. Fractures for the orbital floor may arise due to hydraulic forces causing globe displacement with the compressing fracture into an adjacent sinus hydraulic theory, or post-operative transmission of direct orbital rim force causing buckling of the orbital ball buckling theory, or a combination of these mechanisms. Other minor injuries that have been reported in the literature include weakness of convergence and accommodation after head and mid-facial injuries with an incidence of about 21%. Spontaneous recovery of these injuries is well documented in the literature. Diplopia due to extraocular muscle entrapment can be assessed by forced action test intraoperatively. Major ocular injuries included ruptured globe, retinal hemorrhage, and retinal detachment. Visual loss is an uncommon complication of midfacial fractures, usually caused by injuries directly to the globe, the optic nerve, or the visual pathway. This study has shown that orbital fractures that require reconstruction present with more impairment of visual acuity and minor and major ophthalmic injuries than other midfacial fractures that require repair. Fractures of orbitozygomaticum maxillary complex that is associated with panfacial fractures present with a higher proportion of major than minor ophthalmic injuries, which may be related to the mechanism of injury, whereby the fractures occur at a higher velocity. Only patients who had their fractures repaired were assessed in this study, and this could be introduced an element of bias. Conclusion, though periorbital edema, ecchymosis, subconjunctival hemorrhage, and chemosis are very common and minor ocular complication, it is imperative that the maxillofacial surgeon is fully aware of the vision impairment, hyphema, and Marcus Gunn pupil. Consent forms will have to be explained in detail. The role of oral and maxillofacial surgeon is not to diagnose or manage complex ocular injuries. However, familiarity and recognition of normal findings will guide the clinician to recognize abnormalities via a thorough but directed perioperative ophthalmologic examination, thereby allowing appropriate consultation and communication with the ophthalmologist if necessary. These are my references. Thank you.
So your conclusion is that that is a very good presentation. I mean, your conclusion is that you will subject all the patients with the ZMC fracture for an ophthal opinion, is it?
Dr. Ashwini?
Yes, sir.
So you're asking, will you send all the patients for the ophthalmology reference?
Ma'am, actually with periorbital edema, ecchymosis, and if patient complains of diplopia, and if we find some like teardrop shape of pupil, we should definitely send for an ophthalmologist review, ma'am.
Only in these cases, not all the cases.
Like for all the cases, if infraorbital bone is involved, sir, we used to send for all the cases. But if it is not involved, we don't send, sir.
So if the floor of the orbit and the infraorbital margin is involved, then would you like to go for the reference?
Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Any questions from the participants? Okay. Thank you, Ashwini.
Participants are a very silent lot.
Yeah, I don't know. This is the time when they can ask each other. They should. Doesn't matter. Yeah, I can't help them. Okay, you can proceed to the next one. Yes, sir. Next speaker, please.
Okay. Ma'am, the next speaker is Dr. Pallavi Bharti.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yes,
Pallavi, you are audible.
Okay.
Share your screen.
Yes, ma'am.
Go to the presentation mode. And your time starts now.
Good afternoon, respected jury members and everyone present here. I'm Dr. Pallavi, is going to give my presentation on the topic face-to-face. Starting with the introductory part, face transplantation is a new surgical technique that could be considered as a paradigm change in facial reconstruction, and its goal is not only to restore human appearance, but also to create a new physiognomy that will allow the facial disfigured patient to adapt or reintegrate into life. There are millions of patients worldwide presenting with severe complex craniofacial deformities as a result of trauma, burns, tumor ablation, or congenital disorders. All these patients require surgical reconstruction for restoration of functional, aesthetic, or both. A face transplant replaces all or a part of a person's face with donor tissue from someone who has died. The standard reconstructive procedure with autologous tissues, including skin, muscles, and bones, have their limitations in restoration of complex defects. Face transplant is a complex operation that takes months of planning and multiple surgical teams. The aim of this paper is to provide an overview of the facial transplant surgeries, its advantages, disadvantages, and complications. It's a descriptive review of World English literature performed by web search using keywords like face transplant and facial reconstruction, using the databases like PubMed, SearchDirect, PMC, and HindiVee, and the articles reviewed from 2010 to 2018. Coming on to the history part, the history of the reconstructive surgery of the face is built on a slow natural progression highlighted by a sudden profound changes. The forehead and facial flaps first described by Sushruta Samhita in 600 BCE and was compiled by Wagbert in the 4th century CE. An important milestone in facial reconstruction was reached in 2005 in France. A team led by Dr. Dubernard from performed the first partial face transplantation in a woman who was whose face was severely injured after a dog attack. Then later on, a first full face transplant was done in 2010 in Spain by a team led by Dr. Barrett on a patient called Oscar who lost his facial structure by accident and injury. This breakthrough was followed by more than 37 face transplant procedures performed worldwide. Indications include burns, ballistic traumas, bird defects, animal bites, and tumors like neurofibromatosis. Indications for face transplantation should not be based solely on the injury, but instead should include three elements, that is anatomic deficit, patient characteristics, and transplantation team experience. Limitations include recipient's immunosensitization, mental illness, previous medical histories of blood transfusions or cadaveric skin grafts, and psychological issues. The surgical team includes plastic surgeons, microsurgeons, ENT surgeons, ophthalmologists, oncosurgeons, craniomaxillofacial surgeons, and maxillofacial prosthodontists, anesthesiologists, and radiologists. Now, proceeding to the preparation part, it includes donor and recipient matching, in which HLA typing is done. Imaging includes 3D CT, MRI, CT angiography, nerve function like electromyography, oropharyngeal assessment to identify any underlying dental abscesses or periodontal disease. Screening for carcinomas. Recipients need to undergo screening for any oropharyngeal carcinomas. Women over the age of 40 years should be up to date with mammography, and all patients above the age of 40 years should undergo upper as well as lower endoscopy to detect underlying undiagnosed carcinomas. Anesthetic assessment, routine evaluation of cardiovascular and respiratory status. Donor's prosthesis. Sufficient aesthetic appearance should be obtained post-organ retrieval for donor. Proceeding to the surgical technique. Two surgical teams working simultaneously with one group involved in the procurement of the donor's composite tissue allotransplant and other concerned with the preparation of the recipient to undergo implantation of the donor allograft. After tracheostomy of the donor, maxillofacial prosthodontic team takes an alginate mold of the donor's face and begins the process of creating a facial prosthesis. Then marking the boundaries for the dissection of the donor is done. A stylistic sheet can be employed as a template to delineate the margins that need to be incised. Models produced by 3D printers specifying the exact dimensions of the recipient's defect can help guide the depth of dissection on the donor. A bicoronal incision is often employed in removing the donor composite tissue allograft. This is extended along the subperiosteum up towards the level of the orbits. It is then extended laterally and may include ears if they are needed. However, if not, then a radiectomy incision can be employed. After the initial incisions, the facial flap is elevated and the major vessels are identified, including the facial arteries and external jugular veins. Vascular loops can be employed in labeling them. Deep plane is usually required for the incision so that when undermining of the facial composite tissue allotransplant is being performed, skin, soft tissues, and muscles can all be obtained. Nerves that require transection can be tested by stimulators to assess their functional status before deciding whether to transfer them with the facial composite tissue allograft. In procurement of the craniofacial skeleton, superior osteotomies can be employed just above the lateral canthi bilaterally. The facial arteries and veins are clamped bilaterally and transected for hemostatic control. The defect produced within the donor can be covered up with a silicone prosthesis as aforementioned. If only soft tissues are required, then a subsuperficial musculoepineurotic system graft can be obtained, which involves dissection from the vertex down towards the subpalatal plane. If bony structures are necessary for procurement, then a subperiosteal E4-3 harvest can be conducted. After the harvest, the transplant is flushed with heparinized saline followed by organ preservation solution and carried in a standard icebox. As you can see on the left side, this is a subsmass facial allograft, and on the right side is a subperiosteal LIFO3 graft. The dimensions of the recipient's facial bones are surgically modified to match those of the donor allograft so as to allow for a more natural apposition. A mastoidectomy can be employed to obtain additional facial nerve length within the host. An orbital osteotomy can be conducted to provide the release of an infrabital nerve, which allows for a more tension-free attachment. The exclusion of the parotids allowed for more distal nerve coaptation. This is the final picture of the recipient after receiving the graft. Revision surgeries. These are secondary surgery procedures post-transplantation can be employed in order to revise residual functional and aesthetic defects. These have included bony realignment, soft tissue resuspension, derma abrasion, skin grafting, and fat injection. Post-operative management includes rehabilitation, which further includes speech therapy, physiotherapy, psychological, occupational, and cellular therapies, and nerve function test. Standard immunosuppression regimen begins with a monoclonal or polyclonal anti-lymphocyte antibody. First administration of anti-lymphocyte serum begins in the operating room just after the anastomosis have been completed, and it continues daily. The induction is then followed by a triple therapy regimen, which includes tacrolimus, mycophenolate, mofetil, and prednisolone. Complications include graft rejection, infections, immunological and metabolic problems, sensory and motor functional outcomes, psychological risk, mortality, and miscellaneous, which includes blood loss, chronic renal insufficiency, malignancy, etc. These are some cases of the facial transplantation. In the above pictures, you can see the pre-surgical photos. Patients suffered from any trauma or any birth defect or any kind of tumor. And below are the photos of after the surgery in which the graft has adapted so well. Conclusion: facial transplantation has a unique potential to restore the facial form and function in patients with severe facial defects. This procedure represents the most comprehensive type of transplantation performed to date. To effectively address this challenging surgery, a comprehensive multidisciplinary approach should be devised. Based on the current outcomes, we postulate that facial allotransplantation should be restricted to a selected group of candidates chosen under strict ethical and medical protocols. At last, I want to conclude with a quote. There's no use to give ears to life if you don't give life to ears. These are some of my references. Thank you.
Very well presented, Pallavi. I think a nice presentation and a nicely pictured it. Sir, would you like to ask something?
I have only one question. It's a good presentation.
Thank you.
And how many facial transplants have been done in India so far?
Sir, according to the literature, some of the facial transplant surgeries have not documented. Still, what I have searched, and it is like more than 37 facial transplantation surgeries have done so far, including both partial and full face transplant.
In India, did you understand my question? In India.
Oh, sorry, sir. Sir, in India, there is no documented surgery present.
Okay. Is there any ethical issues to go with this?
Yes, sir. There's proper ethical issues. First, we have to take the donors' donor families' consent, whether they were willing to for the facial, like to give the face to the other person. And one of the like more ethical is if after taking a graft from the donor, we have to give a facial prosthetic to the donor so that after handing over the body to the family, it should look nice. It shouldn't be like a proper disfigured face. So that's why we, after the tracheostomy we done, the impression of the face.
For the recipient, identity is going to change, right?
Yes, yes, sir. His life, his or her life will completely change after the surgery. That's why there are so many therapies after the surgery, including the
psychological. I'm talking about the ethical and the legal implications.
Sir, legally, if any of the institutions, they'll be signing the consent form. And is there any graft rejection occurs post-operative, and if they are not taking the immunosuppressant drugs or any other drugs prescribed, and if anything happened, then the institution won't be held responsible for this, and there sure be the side effects of the drugs and the surgeries would be in the future.
What about the identity?
That there will be a complete new identity. As in the literature as mentioned, the donor's face is combining with the recipient face will give a new face, which will be a completely new face, not similar to the donor or the recipient. So it will be a completely new identity.
I'm trying to say, is there any legal implications in India?
No, sir. There will be no legal implications for that.
Okay. Thank you. That was a nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
I'll just ask you one thing. Is there any case of facial transplant otherwise than in India?
No, sir.
You are talking about donor face transplant, but I am just talking about facial transplant as such. Do you know that any case has been done in India or not? Or you try to search the literature about it?
Yes, sir. I searched in the internet. There is no documented facial transplant surgery present in India. Not even the partial and the...
Just for your information and everybody's information, I would like to share one thing that there was a case of facial transplant, not exactly donor facial transplant, but the same face was again transplanted to the patient in CMC Ludhiana.
Yes, sir, but it was not documented, so I didn't mention.
To tell you that one case was done in India as well.
Yes, sir,
not a donor case, but the same.
Yes, sir. So I knew about this CMC Ludhiana case, but it was not documented, so I didn't mention it, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you so much, sir.
Should we move on to the next speaker?
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. So the next, I would like to invite the next speaker, Dr. Ravalika. Dr. Ravalika, are you there?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Is my screen visible, ma'am?
Yes.
Yes, go to the presentation mode. Go to the presentation mode.
Yes, ma'am.
And your time starts now.
Good evening, everyone. Today, I'm going to present a paper on surgical management of ZMC fractures, setting a gold standard. Coming to introduction, face occupies a prominent position in the human body, making it susceptible to facial injuries, frequent injuries. Zygomaticomaxillary complex fractures is the second most common midfacial fractures and accounts for approximately 15 to 23.5 of maxillofacial fractures. So the prominence of the zygomatic region predisposes it to its injuries. So the patient with ZMC fractures may have restricted mouth opening due to the impingement of the coronoid process or even the zygomatic arch, which is fractured. So disruption of the zygomatic position causes psychological, aesthetic, and functional impact, causing the impairment of the ocular and mandibular function. So therefore, for cosmetic and functional reasons, the bone fracture must be properly diagnosed and managed. So open reduction with surgical incisions can be performed through Keene's approach, infraorbital approach, lateral burrow approach, and hemicoronal approach. So open reduction and internal fixation of displaced fractures of the zygoma is the simplest method of achieving the post-reduction stability. So this study was designed to compare various open reduction and internal fixation techniques previously performed for the better clinical results and fewer complications, consequently providing a better treatment option for the patients. So the aim of this study was to identify protocol for surgical management of zygomatic maxillary complex fractures based on our experience from previous fractures. So this study was approved by the ethical committee. The data of all the patients treated with ZMC fracture at our hospital from June 2016 to November 2019 were collected. The records were reviewed for age, gender, cause of injury, alcohol intake, type of fracture, associated injuries, type of surgery performed, that is incisions given, fixation done, operation time, and complications were noted. So the inclusion criteria was all patients diagnosed clinically and radiographically with ZMC fractures who required open reduction and internal fixation. And the exclusion criteria was patients with comminuted fractures, infected fractures, pathological fractures, and lack of follow-up records. So to, coming to the results, a total of 55 patients were diagnosed with ZMC fractures requiring who required surgery in the study period, of which 46 were male and 9 were female. The male to female ratio was 5.5:1. Age ranged from 17 to 75 years, and the causes noted were road traffic accident, assault, fall, and sports injuries. So bilateral fractures, was observed in 5 patients. Alcohol intake was present in 15 patients. Coming to type of fractures noted, FZ fracture alone was seen in 6 cases. Zygomaticomaxillary buttress fracture was seen in 3 cases. Intraorbital rim fracture was seen in 3 cases. Zygomatic or maxillary complex fracture was seen in 48 cases. The associated facial fractures noted were orbital floor, panfacial fractures, mandible, nasal bone fracture, frontal bone, and temporal bone fractures. So the clinical features commonly seen were head injury, asymmetry, infraorbital rim, deformity, infraorbital nerve paresthesia, positive eye signs, restricted mouth opening, and malocclusion. So the fixation was done in was 1.2 point, 3 point, and 4 point fixation were done. 1 point fixation was done in 12 cases, and the duration of surgery was 40 to 50 minutes. 2 point fixation was done in 12 cases, of which the zygomaticomaxillary buttress and FZ suture was fixed in 7 patients, and zygomaticomaxillary buttress and infraorbital rim was sutured in fixed in 5 cases, and the duration of surgery was around 70 to 80 minutes. 3 point fixation was done in 27 cases, and 4-point fixation was done in 9 cases. As a type of incisions commonly used were existing laceration, hemicoronal incision, maxillary vestibular approach, infraorbital approach, lateral brow approach, and Alcaid Bramley approach. So complications noted were motor deficit of the facial nerve in 1 case, infraorbital nerve paresthesia in 4 cases, entropion in 2 cases, and palpable plates and screws in 6 cases. So coming to displaced or zygomatic bone fractures are at the risk of secondary malposition due to mastigative fossa even after some kind of fixation. So post-reduction displacement of zygoma can result in a delayed development of malar asymmetry and vertical dystopia. Therefore, the goal of the treatment in zygomatic bone fractures is to restore and also maintain the pre-injury facial skeleton configuration. So in our data, as I previously said, males were 63% compared to females. Males are 83% and females are 16%, which was similar to the current literature. Male to female ratio was 5.1:1. This is because females are more confined to indoor activities and where males are exposed to the external environment. Coming to etiology, RT was, as I said, it was seen in 87%. Followed by assault in 7.2%, fall in 3.6%, and sports-related injuries 1.1%. So out of 60 zygomatic fractures in 55 patients, 1-point fixation was done in 12 cases, 2-point also in 12 cases, 3-point fixation in 27 cases, and 4-point fixation was done in 9 cases. Postoperatively, the patients were advised for water view to assess the reduction and fixation. So a mini plate phase placed across only the FZ suture will resist the translatory and rotational movements according along the axis perpendicular to the plane and offer very little resistance to the rotation along the linear axis of the plane. So it was seen that 1-point fixation on FZ suture alone or in the intraorbital region cannot sufficiently stabilize the zygomatic bone against the rotational forces from the masseter upon mastication. So to improve stabilization, an additional plate should be placed where a weak axis of both the plates does not coincide with the line connecting them. So reduction at the FZ suture and intraorbital rim alone can allow constant lateral rotation of the anterior maxillary buttress, leading to an expansion of the intraorbital volume. So that's and it was seen that zygomaticomaxillary buttress plays a key role in withstanding the contraction of the masseter muscle and supporting zygoma. So a rigid fixation at this area is important in treatment of zygomaticomaxillary complex fractures. So 3-point fixation gave maximum stability against forces equaling the physiological stresses. So although zygomaticomaxillary complex fractures are associated with orbital flow defect, not all cases required surgical repair of the flow. Orbital floor exploration was performed only in the case of presence of eye signs, that is, an ophthalmos, hypoglobus, diplopia, restricted eye movement, or any significant with defect with or without ocular muscle entrapment. displaced zygomatic arch fractures changes the anteroposterior dimension direction of the zygomatic body and expands the facial area. So only in displaced zygomatic arch fracture, exact reduction is important to in appropriate reconstruction of the anteroposterior direction of the facial area. Various approaches were used in the zygomatic bone fracture. FZ suture was exposed using lateral bro approach. Infraorbital rim was exposed via subsiliary and infraorbital approaches. Zygomaticomaxillary buttress was approached through Keen's approach, that is intraoral approach, and these fragments, fracture segments were directly visualized, reduced, and fixed using these approaches. In few cases, bicoronal or hemicoronal approaches were also used. So the patients were reviewed post-op relatively on the 3rd, 7th, 7 to 10 days, 1st and 3rd and 6 months. The complications noted, as I said, were motor nerve deficit of the facial nerve in hemicoronal incision, infraorbital nerve paresthesia and entropion in infraorbital incisions, and palpable plates and screws. So to conclude, zygomaticomaxillary buttress first fracture, fracture fixation is proven to provide excellent stability against and also aesthetics. Isolated fixation of FZ suture area does not present a does not present a stable outcome, and there can be a delayed displacement of the zygomatic bone. Infraorbital rim and orbital floor fractures associated only with positive signs or paresthesia present a strong indication for fixation, which can be also managed without any intervention. Zygomatic arch reduction fixation is done only in case of severely displaced fractures, and Waters view of radiograph is most commonly mandatorily used in postoperatively. So these are my references. Thank you.
Yeah, that was a good study. Yeah, one question. Yes. The concluding slide, you mentioned that not all the cases will require fixation, right? So in your study, did you require to fix all the cases? Or was there only any case of only depressed fracture that did not require any fixation?
Yes, sir. That's what infraorbital rim only in case of any positive eye signs or any severe.
No, I'm not talking about infraorbital rim. I'm talking about arch.
Arch, yes, sir. If it's not displaced, we didn't reduce it, sir.
Study, how many cases required fixation and how many cases did not require fixation? I think all the cases were fixed. I'm
nine
not sure
cases whether I missed fixation. Any point. 9 cases fixation was done, sir.
Okay.
In the remaining other cases, yes, sir.
In all the cases, you did the fixation, 1 point or 2 point or 3 point or 4 point.
Yes, you have done fixation in all the cases. Yes, yes. I was telling about zygomatic arch, ma'am. Sorry.
In zygomatic arch, you have done in how many cases?
Yes, 9 cases, ma'am.
9 cases. Which all cases? Yes. When did you select them for the fixation? What was your criteria?
Yes, ma'am. It was severely displaced and clinically, patient was having a severe asymmetry or depression and a reduced mouth opening. These were the criteria selected.
And which plate did you use for the fixation?
Either 2-0 or 4-0. 2-hole or 4-hole plates were used, ma'am.
No. Which system? 2 mm system, 1.5 mm system, or
1.5 mm.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. So we are finished with the speakers.
Yes, ma'am. Thanks a lot, everybody. I, on behalf of the Scientific Committee of the MedCom 2020, wish to extend my vote of thanks to chairpersons of the session, Jimson sir and Zanipam. I also wish to thank all my speakers for the presentation of their important work and sharing with us their important findings as well as the opinion. Well, I have got a deep sense of appreciation for Dr. Romula sir, Shamit, Atul Sharma sir, and all the members of the Uttarakhand AOMSI for making this event possible. I also wish to thank Pritam sir and all the officials of AMSI for putting their trust in us for this event. Last but not the least, I would like to thank Shilpa ji and entire team of A1 Logics for making this thing possible in online in a smooth as well as a coordinated manner. Today we'll be finishing off the session, and in the end, I would also like to point out one thing. lot of our participants had kept the full face photographs of their patient on their presentation. Well, this thing is going live on the face on YouTube, and because of the ethical issues, I request all the participants to cover unnecessary part. We'll be highly thankful for that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Atul. Thank you, the team, organizing team.
Thank you, Janam, ma'am. All the participants will get the certificates by mail.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible.
Though I am traveling, I was not supposed to speak, but I wanted to share one thing that when we were planning midcoms, at that time also we thought that most of the times in student presentations, there is very less attendance. So we made a scientific program in such a way that when the student paper presentation should be standalone, they should not be clashing with big lectures, and so that everybody should participate in student presentation. In 2017, when we did a midcoms in Chandigarh, it was the same thing in the student papers. There was very less attendance. Then in Nepal also, we saw the same thing, in Raipur also. And now in online mode also, the same thing is there. Only the participants, they were there. Nobody else was there in the presentation. So I will request everybody, because everybody are from different colleges, they can at least tell their co-PGs to be there in the session. This is for benefit of everybody. This is not just for taking a certificate of presentation. So if you can actually tell your co-PGs, your friends to participate in the session, it will become more lively and we'll be more happy in doing a session like this. So tomorrow we will be having a session. All of you should come. Today also I saw that the people who are having session tomorrow, they have not attended it. So I would request everybody to please convey this message to all your fellow friends so that they should also join. And tomorrow I hope that the attendance should be more. Today it was, it went to around 35, but then it was just 24. That means all the participants plus the chairperson and the moderators. It should be more. It is not for the sake of certificate, but it is for sharing of the knowledge as well.
Very good suggestion, Dr. Atul.
Sorry if I am wrong somewhere, but...
No. It's, you are absolutely right. We all should share it with our the PGs, all the PGs, first, second, third year, they all should be should join such forums so that they gain from the each other's presentations and ask questions also as well.
And yeah, ma'am, there was no question in the chat box. None of the participants asked any question.
Yeah, this is no exam. This is basically one should interact. One should talk. This is a place where you can talk without hesitation. That should be your motto. Thank you so much, organizing team. We are really honored to be here.
Thank you, Jimson sir. Thank you, Zainab ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
That is a point well taken, Atul.
All the participants will get the certificates by mail only. And Jimson sir and Zainab ma'am, I personally wanted to hand over you the certificates, but unfortunately, so we'll send by mail and sir, hopefully see you next year in Dehradun.
Yeah, definitely.
Amit,
sir.
Amit, welcome to Chennai.
I'll definitely come, sir.
Then 2020 will be continued and... we'll be joining you in Dehradun next year.
Chennai, Delhi, we are frightened to come.
Don't be frightened.
Both the places are hotspots.
Only thing is wearing mask and washing hands.
Though, we are also...
fine. Hello, Atul.
Looking forward to next year.
Yes, sir.
Hopefully all go.
Definitely, sir. Sir. See you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Bye-bye.
Thank you, A1 Logic. Shilpa,
Praveen. Thank you, Shilpa ji. Yes. Thank you, Atul sir. Thank you, Akash. Thank you so much, bhai. Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you all. I'll end the meeting.
Bye.
Yes.